You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
In this lecture, let's investigate further 13th century painting in Italy. Remember, our time is still 1200 to 14 in Italy, but let's focus on painting. Let's begin a further investigation of painting with a reality check about what life was like during the Renaissance in this early period with regard to the tragedy that many people experienced. Many people died or knew people who died of the plague. This is a map of the spread of the plague from the 14th century all the way to the 18th century in Europe. And if you look carefully and you just follow, for example, the darker gold color, they can date the first outbreak of the plague coming from Asia. It is understood that the plague or the Black Death did come from Asia to 1347, and you can see if you just follow the gold color how it moved. And then by 1348, if you look at the green sections, look how quickly major areas were wiped out by the plague. It is estimated that up to 50% of the continent's population disappeared or was lost because of the plague in 5 years, starting from 1347, up to 50%. And the plague will affect life. It will affect everything during this period. And since our study is focused largely on art, you must ask yourself, well, how would the outbreak of a plague contribute, or what kind of effect would that have on art? And I would suggest 2 points, and I'd like to hear if you have others. There is definitely a rise in the commissioning of devotional imagery. As people fear the plague, and as they know people who die of the plague, entire families could be wiped out, there's more of an interest in religion when something like this occurs, and then the commissioning of altarpieces or icons or other objects that provide some kind of spiritual connection or comfort. In addition, we have an increase in the building of hospitals. And hospitals are, of course, architecture. I have an additional assignment when you look at the week one folder, and you will learn a little bit more about hospitals in the Renaissance. I'll just mention right now that some of the really interesting architectural developments occur because hospitals have to be built quickly to serve all of the people who are sick, and if maybe even some survivors of the plague. So there is a rise in architecture during this period due to the plague. And hospitals also at times would bring in altarpieces so that patients in the hospital could see and experience the religious rites. So there's also some interesting connections there. Let's move on to maybe a happier context, a more pleasant context for the period in Italy, 13th and 14th centuries, that is very important to understanding art and culture. And that is the rise of what you call a vernacular language, a vernacular literature. When you use the term vernacular, you are saying that you're writing, for example, in the commonly spoken language. So during this period, Latin was the language of the church, and the very wealthy few, mostly men who were literate, you know, they could read, they would be reading and writing in Latin. But there is a dialect, a Tuscan dialect at the time that people are using to speak. That's called the vernacular. That's the common. That's the one most people speak and many people increasingly can write. And once you have an individual such as Dante, shown here with his books, writing poetry in the vernacular Tuscan dialect, it changes everything because more people can read the literature. It's brought down to the level of all of us versus those few who can speak Latin. And it's a significant development in just the history of culture in the world to use a vernacular literature. And this occurs in Italy when, for example, and there are other writers, but I just isolated Dante starts to write in the vernacular language, and the Divine Comedy is probably his most famous book. It's not really a comedy, everybody, I'm sorry, in the sense you might be thinking. The Divine Comedy is a very long narrative poem in which he describes the afterlife. But remember, at this time, the afterlife is not just heaven and hell. There's a purgatory, which is a limbo. It's a middle phase. And he describes all of these, using his imagination and the vernacular language, he describes all of these parts in the process after death into the afterlife. So the Divine Comedy, with comedy being understood in a very specific way of sometimes if you say, oh, I'm laughing really hard because of a comedic effect or a joke, you're having a release at the end. And in a true sense, that can be a comedy because you have a great release. But from the perspective of our time, talking about hell and purgatory is probably not a comedy in certain ways. So that what you see there is a fresco that was painted that shows Dante. He was depicted in many frescoes. He was a very important figure. And I have written at the bottom of that text, how does this contribute to humanism? Humanism is a major topic you're going to contend with this semester. And one way I want you to be developing a really thorough view of how you would define humanism, bringing a vernacular language in, the language everyone's speaking, is a way to bring humans together. And that could be part of humanism. More of us talking, not just being talked down to by someone who's speaking Latin. Okay, a very significant work that we need to discuss, a painting on an altarpiece, is the Life of Jesus Maestà altarpiece. Usually everyone just refers to this as the Maestà. And this is done, this was painted by the artist Duccio. Very famous piece. And a sad, but a reality in the history of art, fact is that if you look on the left, the front of the altarpiece is a reconstructed view because over time, believe it or not, they sawed off panels of this to sell, and sometimes those panels were stolen. Artworks are always, you know, fragile in this way. People can steal them, or they want a part of them, or the church needed money. So this is a reconstructed view. There's a front view on the left, and then there's a back view. And if you will look at the front, you'll recognize this common Virgin and Child enthroned motif. And then the other panels show saints, and there are some really interesting details. On the bottom level, which is called the predella, there are more parts of the story of the Virgin's life. Let's look at the right. The back shows the passion of Jesus. Passion is the suffering of Jesus that of which the crucifixion is a central part. And even in this small slide, you can see Christ on the cross figures prominently. So consider this altarpiece like a book. This is a book for people who cannot read in certain respects. A person who can get near the altarpiece, that's not going to be everyone, that's going to be priests and some select few, can walk around and even if unable to read, can see these episodes of the story of the Virgin, and then on the back, what happens to her child, so to speak, the Christ child, and his passion. So this is a very interactive piece. It's 7 feet by 13 feet, and it is to be, you could never take this in one glance. It's a living story, right? And for the faithful, it's a constant reenactment of these episodes in the Christian story. Now, Duccio was very interested in naturalism. And this scene, I thought you might be interested in the Last Supper scene, because you are all thinking of Da Vinci's Last Supper, but the Last Supper is depicted by many artists in these times, okay? It's not, he's not the only one. And if you will ask yourself, what do I see that makes things look more natural? You can look at the facial expressions. Each person is different. Each person has a bit of a different body posture, different hairstyle. Some people are shown older than others. And that contributes to the sense of naturalism. And there's a good sense of space here. You can see they're sitting in a room. There's a bench. Some of the disciples on the bottom have their legs over a bench. And that definitely contributes to the sense of a stage and more of a three-dimensionality. That's a hard word to say. Okay, so a few things that might interest you. I bet you're looking at the figure slumped over to our right, seated next to Christ. That is the disciple John. And that figure will become very interesting to the author of the Da Vinci Code. You may have seen the movie or read the book by Dan Brown. Some people have interpreted that figure as a feminine figure, and that leads to this whole story of the Da Vinci Code. I'll let you guys research, or I'll let all of you research that yourself. But in this case, you see the extreme suffering of the disciple John. And in addition, you see how his elbow is in front of Christ's arm? These are some of those techniques that make figures look more human and as though someone is in front of someone else in a very realistic looking way. So that is the disciple John. Now, where's Judas? You always have to have Judas in the Last Supper, of course. So if you look at Christ's right hand, he's passing bread to a figure, the second figure from our left with the orange, large orange garment. That's Judas, and that is understood from other ways that Duccio portrayed Judas, that is the figure of Judas. And he doesn't have bread in his hand yet. And if you don't know the stories coming from the Christian examples in the class, like the story of the Last Supper, look them up, just to refresh yourself. And they're described in your textbook as well. But, you know, Judas will betray Christ. The animal that they're eating from that large plate, that is called Paschal lamb, and that is a lamb that has been slaughtered for Passover. So here we have may I go back for a moment? That's just one panel, okay? That level of detail and artistry is just one panel from the entire altarpiece. We will end this segment with the work of two brothers, Pietro Lorenzetti and Ambrogio Lorenzetti. Let's start first with Pietro, and sadly, both brothers died in the plague, which is just a sad part of the story. But let's look at Pietro's work, The Birth of the Virgin, and let's introduce the topic of worldly realism. It's essential, and we've already seen it in our first lectures for this course. Worldly realism occurs when you take a scene of religion, okay, this is the birth of the Virgin Mary, and you set it in a worldly or familiar real interior. And if you look just first at the interiors, this is a typical home of the time. And the Renaissance artists loved to do this to make us feel as though religious events could happen in our own home, or in an environment that's familiar to us. And so you combine realism with the idea of, yes, that looks like a cover on a bed, that checkerboard kind of cover that I know people have. That humanizes things. That humanizes a story. So worldly realism, very important. Now, Pietro Lorenzetti had studied with Duccio. We know then that he was a really good student, right? Because he got to study with the master. He worked in Siena. He liked the worldly realism style. And please notice that this is a triptych, meaning a three-paneled altarpiece, a story shown in three panels. And if you look at the panels, you will see in the middle, we have Saint Anne reclining on a bed after giving birth to the Virgin Mary. Anne was the mother of the Virgin Mary. If you go to the left, you see a man in the yellow garment sitting with the kind of interesting beard and hairstyle. That is Joachim. Joachim is Anne's husband and the father of the Virgin Mary. So this story from the Virgin's life, her birth, is being isolated in this 6x5 panel, tempera on wood. I have a detail of the panel on the right, and these are women, because I wanted you to see more of the style of painting from Pietro Lorenzetti. These are women bringing gifts upon the birth of the Virgin. The birth of the Virgin is not probably as popularly shown in more modern times as it might surprise you, I think, that yes, the Virgin Mary, according to this theology, had, you know, she had parents, and this may be new for some of you. I always find it interesting. So we have worldly realism. This is an altar. In the background of this slide, you can see the curtains. So this is placed in a cathedral, and then it is so strongly 3D. It looks like those are little miniature, those, each part is a miniature room. But this is highly illusionistic painting where an artist can make you feel like something is in three dimensions, but it's as flat as a pancake, right? So that's one of the great things of Pietro Lorenzetti's style. His brother, Ambrogio. Ambrogio Lorenzetti did one of the rarest examples of a fresco painting that has nothing to do with religion, per se, during our period. This dates here, 1338 to 1339. This was a fresco program based on an allegory. An allegory is a story that has a hidden or implied meaning that's usually moral or nature, or of a political nature. So an allegory is a story that has more to it than what you see on the surface. So he created a series of frescoes in the public, the Palazzo Pubblico in Siena, but these frescoes were actually in this one room for the Council of the Nine. These were elites who basically made the laws. And they told the story of the city. Okay, so here's the peaceful city. Look at the group on the lower left. They're even holding hands. Everything is working. This is good government. People have jobs. There's business occurring. The city looks nice and clean. I know this looks a bit dark. Probably, you know, over time frescoes darken because of smoke and other things. So that's really all well and good. What happens when there's a bad government? Well, Lorenzetti included that. And this is a detail from this larger fresco. And look carefully, you see who's in charge now? The guy with the horns? Bad government was associated with hell. And I know you're all thinking of jokes right now, but it really was associated with this notion of hell and Satan. And look at the figure with the cloven hoofs, the animal there on the right. This fresco needs a lot of restoration. It's my understanding that it hasn't been restored as many people would like. So what you see that looks like blotched out areas, those are problem areas that need restoration. And it's very notable that during the Renaissance, there was just as much interest. Was it a warning? There's a peaceful city. Is that city peaceful because you allow the Council of Nine to rule the city and you don't challenge their authority? That's an idea put forth by scholars. Accept the powers. Otherwise, you're going to end up with this. It's hard. There are many possible ways to interpret this good and bad government. But no matter how you cut it, there were always in history, there have always been politics and there have always been good and bad governments. And this particular fresco, as we conclude this talk, this fresco really is unusual because we've looked at already many religious themes. It's not necessarily a religious theme. It's a secular theme, although it's Satan really who rules the bad government. That is it for this talk. I look forward to speaking with you soon about more art from the early Renaissance.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.